So, one final reveal, and this is a giant one. I'm just gonna let it play. Guys, make sure that you hit the like button if you enjoy this, and we've done reveal videos for pretty much everything out of Genesis, so go ahead and check those out. I'll leave links down below.
Yeah, that right there is our lunar biome. What do you guys think? You know, this is such a great environment. It's probably the craziest biome we've ever done in ARK because it doesn't just look awesome, but we totally changed the physics and the gravity in the lunar biome. It's like you're bouncing around when you jump. It's when you're running, you're like got a little extra bounce in your step. There's all sorts of hazards and environmental things related to the low gravity. And all of the stuff in the environment is really made for this biome, including these things here, which is the Astrocetus, is our space whale, for if you want to give it a fun common name there. These things are pretty awesome as well. I'll let Zane talk a little bit about the gameplay stuff. But the team's really excited about the lunar biome. It's just one of the cool biomes. You saw the new bog earlier on Extra Life with the Bloodstalker in it. Just like the bog, it's such a cool new place to play in the game, and we've really tried to pull out all the stops for the environments here in Genesis, as you can hopefully tell from this crazy psychedelic lunar biome. It's orbiting a strange planet. As the day cycle goes on, you're on this sort of broken moon that's like orbiting around the planet. It's got rings, there's galaxies in the background, and this crazy awesome fog, this sort of like this element fog that's kind of just roaming around, and this gaseous stuff that's there, and it's such a cool environment. What else can you tell us about it, Zane?
Let me get my mic on. It's definitely hazardous. It's a challenge to be there. It's very fun with the low gravity just by itself. All the bouncing around that you can do, jumping to much higher places. There'll also be oxygen vents to help supplement your breathing. It does have an atmosphere. It's just a much lower atmosphere, so your oxygen will slowly drain over time. And there will be these oxygen vents that you can use to either get oxygen or actually launch yourself around.
Yep.
To get to much higher or further places.
What about the sunlight and the day-night stuff?
So, and that's the catch. As you're traveling around and as the sun is rotating around this conglomerate of rocks that you're inhabiting, you don't have a thick enough atmosphere to actually protect you. So once that sun starts to hit you, it's just immediate night and day difference. You start to roast. You start to just take immediate effects from it.
So it's a little bit like aberration, but maybe not as extreme.
Well, and it actually matches the sun.
Yeah.
It's we're fully going into it, and it's perfect. If you find a rock with a little place to hide under, you'll be safe. Suddenly, those big pyres in the terrain are super helpful because they help you navigate around the sun and stay safe.
So if you see some shadows and you get in the shadows, you're going to be
totally
protected
fine.
From that. Yeah, or if you're running without shadows, I guess if you can see the sun or not.
So that's going to be a little difficult. Yeah.
But I mean, it's probably if the sun's blocked by a rock, you're probably safe even if you have shadows turned off.
Yeah, exactly. So for those of our illustrious players that love SM4 with no shadows and the lowest quality possible, the lunar biome, they'll still know where the hazard's at by looking for the sun, but they will have to look for the sun and make sure it's blocked.
Yeah.
Everyone else will be able to see the shadows and know exactly where it's coming from, and it will be very clear night and day. If you're in the shadows, you're safe. If you're in the sunlight, it's a little dangerous.
Totally.
And it gets pretty fun jumping from rock to rock every now and then. That sunlight's coming straight from below.
Yeah.
So as you're jumping across, you're taking a little bit of damage, and you're just like, oh, I hope
it's burning
your
the bottoms of your feet as exactly. you're jumping. Out, yeah. Speaking of jumping on top of things, tell us a little bit more about this Astrocetus. Pretty sure they can have a little bit of fun jumping from creature to creature, right?
Oh yeah, these guys are amazing. Being an Astrocetus, a space whale of sorts, they have a lot of magical abilities. Their main one being that they have a teleport, a hyperdrive of sorts. And what that does is anything within their close range or their immediate vicinity will actually be pulled into this bubble and blinked into their target destination as a group or as a fleet.
And you can control that when you tame these creatures, right?
Yes. Once you get through the taming process, which is not going to be an easy feat. These things are definitely an alpha tame. They're a top tier tame, so they're going to be a very difficult thing to get, and they're going to be a limited thing to get. We don't want everyone having 1,000 of these. They are going to be very, very, very capable.
I still imagine like about 4 or 5 of these blinking in like Star Destroyers coming in to like
yes.
mess with somebody.
Well, and then once they get there, what are they going to be bringing? What is a Astrocetus really going to be doing? And in all honesty, their travel abilities are really all they're good at in combat. They have a great bite. They have an awesome tail whip, which looks beautiful. But compared to other dinos, that's not much. But they do make up with their saddle, which is next tier of any saddle we've ever done. Because this saddle comes equipped with three ball turrets.
So it's like a World War II bomber or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you can not only bring your fleet in with you, but you also come equipped with gun turrets to just pummel the enemy or whoever's coming after you.
Or like the Millennium Falcon or something.
Yes, or like nice. The Millennium Falcon.
Get on the gunner. Yeah.
That's yes. cool. But what if they're not tamed in the environment? I think you can jump on them, and they're kind of docile, aren't they, unless you kind of provoke them?
Yeah, they won't mess with you, and they'll leave you alone. If you do provoke them, they will definitely try to push you out, and they don't like being stuck in one place.
Yep.
They're very difficult to get locked down, and part of that taming process is a very involved tame, and if you try to game it, it's not going to work out well for you. They can blink out of existence.
Indeed. So what else we got in the lunar biome? We got any fun missions or any like fun little cool things that happen there?
It's funny you say that. We haven't said anything about missions.
this whole time. Now's as good as time as any to talk about a little bit of missions.
So
we did our best. We did real well.
Well, there was one guy that was just consistently asking, and I wanted to say something, but it wasn't on the schedule, and I don't want to break.
Well, you know what? We don't have to talk a lot about missions because we do want to kind of have a more fun reveal of that later.
And
the missions are super cool. There's a lot of, like, really fun, both action-packed, but also exploratory and relaxing. There's, like, a wide variety of mission types. But let's talk about one right now that's just a little bit of a silly, fun mission that we decided to throw in. And what is it, Zane?
So we're going to have dodo basketball or in space.
On the moon?
We're going to have bulb dog basketball.
Nice. So it's
because
like,
that's the best
basketball. So it's like Space Jam in the moon.
On the moon.
Low gravity basketball as a mission.
Low gravity made this actually a really difficult thing to do. Because initially we started off with normal values. And low gravity works really well. Projectiles go a lot further with a lot less force. So whenever I first started this mission, we'd already built it out for a different place.
That's pretty cool.
Well, we started converting the low grav. It was just launching the poor thing into space. I felt so
bad. I can imagine there's probably so many things on Lunar with the low gravity that have been like...
Oh, it's going to be a blast.
Yeah. And I've played it a fair bit, and not only is it fun, but sometimes it's super disorienting, like when you're doing a little bit too much, and you get kind of like the low gravity spins going on. How's
that
trigger?
So every time you've seen any spacewalk or anything like that, there's always a little bit of difficulty of staying oriented.
Yeah.
And the higher you go up, the easier it is for your character to get a little off track, or if you've been bumped a little bit, or if you're in a fight, it's going to be a lot more common. and you'll start to lose your orientation and shift on all 6 degrees of your axis. It'll be limited, so it's not so disorienting that it's nauseating, but you will be able to rotate around, and you'll be able to control that too.
Yeah.
But going along with just the amount of distance you can jump, it gets quite exciting and fun to just try to platform around under the new, entirely new rule set of low gravity.
It's pretty awesome. Well, cool. Anything else top of mind for this creature in this biome we want to hit on before we...
Well, we talked about the gunner turrets, and it has something else because obviously the rider would be probably bored while all of his friends are doing all the fun stuff. So it also has its saddle that will convert its energy that it gains, its natural space energy, into bombs.
Mm.
And then those will be what the rider can control and drop from its bomber mode. So you can teleport in, drop bombs, covered on your fire on your way out, and then if the teleport recharges in time, which it's not going to be a quick recharge, but if that engagement you've survived, you're able to teleport back out. But that'll take quite a while. That's going to be a difficult one.
Genesis 1.
Very careful where you teleport this guy into. Because you could show up into a lot of things that you didn't see before.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. Got to scout the area out. It's just like hyperspeed or light speed.
Yeah.
You know, if you don't know where you're going, it could turn out real bad. Ran into Alderaan.
I was trying to think, like, how many actual times do we show that in movies and stuff where you actually go somewhere and you accidentally, like, collide with something on the way? It seems like it would happen all the time right? with, like, little specks of dust or rocks and just, like, destroy your ship. But it's like,
there's so much
we hand
way.
Wave it in sci fi. It's like, we got, like, deflector shields and who's it, what's it, and things that, like, prevent
it's
the
laser
collision-y
shields.
Stuff
they burn it all up.
From happening.
From going so fast, right? Like,
The heat you created just blasted through it. It's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
You're at a new speed. It doesn't. It's fine. You face through.
Yeah, like the Star Wars scene where like they go straight through the destroyer.
Yeah,
and that's how they work.
Which was actually like one of the coolest things.
It was
like,
cool looking.
Yeah, because it's like never really addressed, and then like you see like the destroyer get ripped apart, and you're like, oh, so there is some physicality to this whole thing.
Yeah.
It's not just magical stretchy stars that shouldn't let me
like
go somewhere
right
else. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, and that carnage is great.
Was are we doing any sort of ramming with the blink, or are we just letting it?
No ramming.
Phasing through things.
But being a whale, it does have a movement mechanic.
Yeah.
It starts off really, really, really slow. It's a big giant whale. And then as you keep moving forward, you slowly start to ramp up in speed. And it's almost like a gearing system.
Hmm.
And you'll get a little notification of when it's reaching those higher speeds. And then the faster you're going, the straighter his turns have to be, or the narrower his turns have to be. And if you overturn, it'll actually slow him down. So he's something that you want to build up momentum to get to an effective speed, because if you come in at a low speed or you come in on a sharp turn, you're going to get slowed way down and be a very, very vulnerable target because you're just floating almost in space.
Nice.
So how you move, how the pilot controls this thing is extremely important. And choosing when
it sounds like a pretty powerful thing. It's maybe a little more high level to.
It's definitely high level, and it takes coordination. Like, the whole team needs to be working together. And it's a team tame. You can control it solo. You can be sitting in the turret and just whistling it around. It's a little difficult because you got to go forward and then look to where you're aiming. But it's even solo players will be able to experience the full plethora of what this whale can do and what he can deliver.
So what about some of the other creatures we might find on the lunar biome? Is there anything that's hanging out there or any creatures you might want to bring in that are particularly helpful?
It's going to be a very, very, very unique biome. Being that it's a low gravity, low atmosphere environment, the creatures that can survive there are going to be very unique creatures. A lot of them we've seen in aberration because they grew on a planet that was or an arc that was destroyed and was toxic in a hostile environment. So reapers would be a common thing. Our favorite pterotoothuses are definitely going to show up. I like to think of them as the Minoc of the litter biome, but I'm just the nerd. And then, of course, we'll have quite a few of the bionic dinos there to supplement the environment and also create a challenge. It's not going to be a low-level experience. This is definitely the higher-end, very, very, very challenging environment. But if you can survive here, it's very rewarding. And, of course, the resources are going to be absolutely top tier. Like, this is a place that you want to be able to get to.
What kind of stuff is going to be available to us there?
Everything.
Everything?
everything at top tier. Definitely the element in inachievable amounts. Metal, for sure, is going to be in abundance. These are places that you want to go to get those materials that are your final in-game crafting. And this will be a place that you can just one-stop shop it, but it'll be difficult to be there, and you have to pay attention to what's going on around you, because as that sun comes around, there's also a meteor storm that will be following along.
Got some hazards.
There's a couple hazards. Low gravity alone is a hazard in itself, because you have to watch out what you're doing. But on top of that, you're floating through a ring system of planets, and as you go through that, it brings a lot of meteors with it.
That's cool.
And that's changing its direction as you're orbiting around the planet that you're orbiting around.
How deadly are the meteors? Or are they just kind of annoying?
They're not nice meteors.
Yeah.
They're moving pretty fast. The surface is not a great place to live. And this is a place to go and farm and harvest. And we're going to use a lot of it for missions.
Cool.
Because it's a great challenging place.
So there we have it. That is all of the reveals for Genesis. This lunar biome looks just incredible. I can't get over how awesome this is going to be. And even just the stuff that they said about it, man, this is going to be probably the best DLC by far. But yeah, that's it for today, guys. If you did enjoy the video, go ahead and hit the like button. Like I said, there's tons of Genesis reveals and everything, so go ahead and check those out. And yeah, catch you in the next one.